The New York Islanders, my favorite sports team on this planet and the namesake of this YouTube channel. For the past 8 years, I've spent tons of time watching, cheering for, and analyzing this team I love so much. I've always wanted to share my thoughts on this team each season, and now that I have this platform, I think it's time to do so. As the diehard fan I am, I've not missed a single game in 8 years, and I have a deeper understanding of what makes this team so good, where we struggle, and how we can improve. In this video, I'm going to break it down into sections. Our last season's positives, the negatives, off-season changes, and new season hopes. I truly believe with the right amount of good decisions by the staff, cohesiveness of the players, and lack of bad luck, this team can win the Stanley Cup next year. If you are not a hockey fan and are a subscriber of this channel, please stick around. Hear me out for what I have to say, and maybe, who knows, maybe we'll have some hype Islanders game watch parties this season. For everyone watching, thanks for doing so as I branch off from my typical content to make a video about something I've always wanted to discuss, the Islanders. I hope to make this postseason recap an annual occurrence, so please enjoy the Islanders 2021-2022 season recap. It's no surprise to anyone who stayed informed about the NHL this year that the Islanders season took a turn for the worst at the beginning. After missing the Stanley Cup Finals by 2 games and 1 game to the eventual champions in the past 2 seasons respectively, the Islanders were poised to go just as far this season, but that was not the case at all. After a few strokes of bad luck, it looks like the Islanders' season was essentially over by September, leading to their eventual missing of the playoffs by just 1 spot. While the season was not something that the Islanders were hoping would happen, there are always bright spots to pick out. The first of these showcases the tenacity that this team had, after they were dealt a really poor hand, and also shows the X factor that this team has, and has had for the past few years, and makes them one of the most unique teams in all of sports. The Islanders do not have any superstar players. Matt Barzal, Brock Nelson, and others are extremely good, but none of them can carry the team single-handedly like Connor McDavid or others. The Islanders get their talent not from the talent itself, but from their chemistry. Pulling together all their talent, they are probably one of the weaker teams in the league, but they are able to work together so well and play like the family they are, to the point that the team is greater than the sum of its parts. This is the reason they were able to make it so far in the playoffs the past 2 years, and how after the first terrible few months of the season, they were able to keep fighting and push hard for their spot to hopefully get into the playoffs. It did not turn out in their favor, but throughout the entire season, that chemistry kept them together. From the excellent defensive pairings of Pelikan-Pulak, to the fourth line, who is the best example of hockey chemistry in the league, to the goalies playing for each other every single game, the Islanders' chemistry was kept strong this season, and gives hope for the next one. One of the reasons that I feared would cause the eventual downfall of the Islanders was losing this intangible sense that they have together. But despite their struggles this season, it does not seem to be the case, and gives me hope that they will bounce right back next year. Along with the intangible aspect of the game, there were some players who boasted tangible stats as well, such as goals, assists, and excellent defensive play. The first of these who changed the script on his game was Brock Nelson. Nelson has always been an outstanding player, but an extremely streaky one. From the motto of Brocktober to his struggles down the stretch, Nelson has never been able to really keep his outstanding play up throughout an entire season. Until this year. Racking up a career-high 37 goals and 59 points, Nelson was the star of the team this year, and was a central player that others could focus their skills around. While other than Nelson, the offensive side of this team was lacking overall this year, they did have a few bright spots, but this was not the case for the goalies, who did their very best to carry the team on their backs every single game. Both Semyon Varlamov and Ilya Sorokin played outstanding and showed off not only the Islanders' premier goalie coaching, but also their ability to stay focused and calm in a season where they did not have much support in the offense or defense. Sorokin, in his second year on the team, became one of the best goalies in the league in almost all stats against some other goalies whose stats were boosted by their team helping them out. While there is still no defined starter and backup for the Islanders, despite a pretty clear distinction, the staff's decision to keep it technically ambiguous allowed both of the goalies to get the care from the coaches that they deserve to make them both better and not compete against each other, but for each other. By having the ability to switch up the goalies if one's having a bad night or stretch of games, and the ability to keep a hot goalie in for net without feeling the notion to switch back to the starter, gave the Islanders the ability to play better, and it shows for it, as they kept this team alive. While for this season, their strong efforts did not result in a playoff spot, their continued amazing play shows that these goalies will not be a problem for next season. While there were tons of positives for the Islanders this season, the overall season was certainly a step backwards and a negative one for the team, as the direction they wanted to head did not happen. There were many factors to the poor performance, and while many of them were the fault of the team, the two biggest factors were out of their control. With the construction of a new stadium in UBS Arena, an amazing stadium I will say, the Islanders started out on an almost month and a half long road trip. This meant that the team not only had to travel around the US and Canada for almost 2 months without a long trip home to be with their families, they also missed the home crowd of the Islanders fans, who give the biggest home field advantage in almost all of sports. They struggled tremendously on the road due to a poor scheduling error by the league, but the true offense is what happened afterwards when they returned. In another stroke of bad luck, a vast majority of the players came down with a certain disease once the team returned to Long Island, forcing them to pull up players from their AHL team, giving the team more AHL players than NHL players at some points. For some reason, even though over half the Islanders players were out sick, the NHL did not postpone their games, as they did so with many other teams over this season, due to much minor circumstances. Since the league wanted the money from the Islanders coming to their new arena for the first time, they kept them playing and losing, which put the Islanders into a 20-game stretch of a horrible record, and once the year hit 2022, the Islanders season was essentially over due to circumstances outside of their control. Other than these two detrimental factors, I will not lie and say there were not other reasons as to why the Islanders did not thrive this season. As much as I hate talking about certain players on the team and how much they hurt the team since all the Islanders are family, Zdeno Chara's play this season was something else, and not in a good way. The addition of Chara back to the team didn't seem like the best move. While he was an amazing player back in the day, he was just too old and slow to be able to play in the league nowadays, especially with a team like the Islanders. His poor defensive capability stemming from his lack of mobility and speed gave the offense for the opposition a free window into the goalies for a third of the game. And for some reason, even with his horrible stats the entire season, the coaches and staff never decided to bench him for a younger and more talented player. It was almost as though they were doing this in order to keep him on the team since he was a good player in the past, a terrible reason for keeping him on the ice the whole season. He did not play defense, had no offense, only scoring 2 goals the entire season, and both in garbage time and losses, and was a bad addition to the team that brought down whoever his defensive linemate was at the time. I love the guy, since he was an Islander, but he kind of single-handedly brought the team down a level every single game. This hurt especially, since even with the injury to Scott Mayfield that left him out for most of the season, the defense played pretty well other than Chara, but the offense also did nothing to help them. It took a ton of time for players such as Zach Parise, Anthony Beauvillier, and Anders Lee to get on their feet and back to regular play like they had in years prior, and the whole offense suffered from this. Only 2 players had above 20 goals and only 2 above 30 assists, and one was a defenseman, Noah Dobson. And no one got more than 60 points despite Brock Nelson and Matt Barzal coming close with 59. Usually these stats are fine for the Islanders, as stated before. It's not one player that scores all the goals and gets all the points, but rather the team as a whole getting above average stats. But this year the team did not have a smooth flowing gameplay with each other. In past season, the team averages for these stats have been a lot higher. With all these problems during the season, this leads into an offseason where it's time for the Islanders to make some changes, and not make others, to bounce this team right back to the Eastern Conference Finals, and hopefully a Stanley Cup championship. After looking at the last season, let's not hark on the past, and look at the current standing of the Islanders in the offseason, and the changes they have to make that are currently being made, and the ones that the team should make. As for changes already made, there's one crazy big one. The Islanders decided to, after his 4th year with the team and first time missing the playoffs, fire Barry Trotz, the Islanders' coach and one of the best coaches of all time. At first, this seems like the worst decision in the world, and while it's clearly confusing, and not one of the greatest moves in my opinion, the news around the move makes a little more sense. Apparently, Matt Barzal, the team's best player, and Trotz wanted to take the teams in different directions, assumingly a slower defensive play from the coach and a fast-paced game from the player. So, in this scenario, the move to choose Barzi over Trotz is a right one, if it was the only option, but I find that hard to believe that there is no other way the team, one that's such a close family, could do nothing about it. However, once the move was made and there was nothing to do, the team, especially Lou Lamoriello, righted the ship in the best way possible and hired the assistant coach, Lane Lambert, as the head coach. Now is the point in the video where I will transition from past events to theoretical future events, as I, someone who's a self-proclaimed expert on the team, believe would be the best moves to make this offseason. In my opinion, this can be summed up to 5 moves. The first would be remove Char from the team. Again, I love Char as an Islander, but he is no good for the team and single-handedly caused us to lose some games. Taking him off the team would be the first and primary thing to do this offseason, which is seemingly going well after the Islanders traded their draft pick for Alexander Romanov, a strange pick for a player, but shows how desperate the Islanders are to remove Char from this team. The second major change, or lack thereof in this case, is to keep the team together. There are many talks of Beauvillier or Bailey getting traded, but while I would understand this perspective from someone who doesn't know the team inside and out, this is where Islanders insight comes into play. Since the Islanders rely so much on their chemistry, removing one piece up from the puzzle, even if they seem unimportant in the long run, causes the whole team to crumble, as seen with Jordan Eberle being lost to the Seattle Kraken this season. Even though it would just be a player on a contract, which in theory would be beneficial to the team, it means that the chemistry that the team had spent years building and what makes them so good and tricky to play against would be thrown out the window. So, keeping the team together is essential for next season, as an individual offensive player's lack of stats do not necessarily come from their own poor play this season, but from the team as a whole, and taking it out on one player would hurt the team more than help. Next, and the third most important for the offseason, is trying to get an offensive player to fill in the holes that were on this team. Hey, so this is Islanders a couple days after I'm recording this footage. After the whole situation with Johnny Gaudreau, for those who don't know, one of the best free agents, Johnny Gaudreau from the Flames, was up for someone to take him, and the Islanders and the Devils were in the running, and it was seeming like the Islanders were pretty much going to get him, who is exactly who I was talking about in the past recording, who would fill this role. But for some reason, they could not close the deal, and he went to Columbus of all players out of nowhere. And the more I thought about this move, yes, Johnny Gaudreau would have totally saved that spot right there and would have been perfect. But now that someone like his caliber is out, I think that this third point should be that the Islanders, again, stay put like the second. If they try and go for someone who's of a lesser caliber, it might screw with the Islanders' chemistry. And so I'm going to amend this point to kind of be non-existent after events that have happened in the past. Back to current Islanders. This also ties into the fourth most influential change, getting a defenseman to fill Chara's hole. This has seemingly been done with Romanov, but someone like Klingberg could potentially be better. Now these players can be either from offseason acquisitions or training a younger player to permanently fill these roles, as done with Dobson and Wahlstrom this season. Finally, the fifth and really most important offseason move is to finalize the lines for next season. This current season was filled with line changes and trying to get things to fit, but there's a pretty clear line system that's worked before in the past and can work now. With the combination of Barzal, Bailey, Beauvillier, Lee, Nelson, and Pageau on the top two lines, Parisi, Wahlstrom, and Palmieri on the third, and the classic fourth line of Cizikas, Martin, and Clutterbuck, pulling out the offense, and on D, throwing Pelech and Pulak right together, Mayfield and Dobson, and then Green and whoever, Romanov maybe, in the back, this would help the team immensely. Throwing these lines together and keeping them sound would make for a great team next year, as it lets chemistry build up between these players, which helps the Islanders so much. Let's hope Lou Lamoriello watches this video and thinks about these 5 points when making summer decisions. Now that all the theoretical points about last season and the offseason have been made, it's time to discuss my 5 hopes for the 2022-2023 Islanders season. The first one was the biggest and most controversial move made this offseason, the swapping coaches. The hope is that Lane Lambert can show that his decision to choose him over the Islanders going out and hiring a new coach was the right move. In past decades, there have been seasons where ex-assistant coaches take the lead role and has not turned out well for them. So Lambert needs to ensure that the season does not follow that route. He has the skills, the relations with the players and the supporting staff to do it, but it's solely up to him to put all of that into one season and ensure that the Islanders go right back to how they were from 2019 to 2021. The next hope for next season is that the struggling players bounce back to their former selves. As stated before, it was really just this season that players such as Josh Bailey and Anthony Beauvillier really started to slack on another level. So the fanbase and the players themselves know that they have it in them to score and assist more, but somehow, through the offseason, they need to prove to themselves they can in fact do it, proving to the rest of the league that they should in fact keep their spot on the roster as opposed to another player. If all players are playing at their top, there's no doubt that the Islanders can win it all. The reason seasons like this current one occur is when too many of the players, top or not, struggle to pull their weight and perform their job, which leads to the whole team also struggling due to the unique chemistry that drives the Islanders forward unlike any team in the league, shattering. If these positive changes were to occur, there's no doubt that the Islanders would excel. Third on my list of hopes for next season speaks to the struggles the Islanders have had for some years now, their intangibility to gain standing against their opposition down the stretch. In the last months of the season, where other teams are really picking it up right before playoff time, the Islanders seem to have had this issue where they start to slow down. This has not been a huge issue in the past, as they were already in a playoff spot, but in a season where they might be running for a spot against other amazing teams in the Metro, being able to push hard one last time at the end would be crucial to their hopeful success. In other years, and this upcoming one especially, it's going to be really tough due to the pure schedule at the end. But with determination and years of great seasons, they should be able to find the energy to make it, especially if a playoff spot is on the line. Fourth is a simple request, just merely some luck. As mentioned before, the catalyst for the Islanders' downfall this season was poor luck and the NHL's lack of cancellation. So this upcoming season, the new arena will not be an issue, and hopefully the team can stay healthy. This will give them more time to adjust to the typical top-tier playing and give them an edge against other teams that they did not have this year. Just the ability to take teams down in which they should have beaten and just get a few more points up on the board in the standings would be tremendously helpful. Finally, the fifth and biggest hope for the season is, of course, that the Islanders win the Stanley Cup. If they go back to their old form with new critical additions, this is clearly possible, as the only thing stopping them in the past seasons was the Tampa Bay Lightning, a team who now, as was seen this year, is capable of falling. This past season has been an unforeseen struggle for the New York Islanders, after very little change on their end from the prior two seasons. With a few changes, alterations, and continuity, this team can go right back to where they were about a year ago, a serious contender to win the Stanley Cup. Through a combination of strong offensive changes and the team finding chemistry that made them so unique and unpredictable to their opponents in the past, the Islanders can become one of the great teams once again in the NHL. Thank you so much for watching this video, and be sure to like, comment, and subscribe for more content. I know for my typical audience this is not a normal video, but it was one I've been wanting to make for a really long time. Don't worry, regularly scheduled uploads are coming soon. And as always, let's go Islanders!